The first part is introduction to smart sensors. Then in the second part, we will talk about specifically on PVDF sensor, and in the third part, we will show how that can be used in the pipe health monitoring robot. Okay. So, these are the three sequence of things, and the first one is little longish, the second and third one is relatively smaller in size. Now, whenever we say that, you know, we are going to introduce the smart sensor, the first important point is that what is a smart sensor? Okay, what is the definition of a smart sensor? So, first important point is that a smart sensor is based on multifunctional materials. In the next slide, I will explain it to you, but invariably all smart sensors are based on multifunctional materials. That is a very, very important characteristics of it. The second point is, because it is made of multifunctional materials and of course, a bit of, you know, making the system actually plays the role, it can respond to both change in external as well as internal environment. Okay. So, you just compare a smart sensor with your body itself, right. So, there is, if there is a change of temperature, for example, outside, you can sense it. Again, if there is internally, you get feverish, you can sense that. So, you have both the capacity of external as well as internal sensing. A smart material exactly in the same way, if there is any crack or any failure on the smart material, it can sense it because the voltage will abruptly get changed. And if there is anything external like some strain that it is subjected to, it can sense that as well. So, it can sense both the things, both external as well as internal environment. And how does it respond to that? It produces invariably a significant change. This significant change is important, because every other day you will find that people will claim we have discovered a new smart material, but having a little bit of change is of no engineering significance to us. It has to have a significant change in either electric charge or magnetic flux. Now, there is a reason why we generally, you know, pick only these two. Electric charge or the electric current is our final goal. Why? Because it is only in this form you can transmit the signal to a very long distance without you know, the substantial loss in the system. Okay. Suppose you might have seen that in your you know, I do not know whether you have seen or not, that in the railway crossings, okay, there is this mechanical locks there. Okay. So, it is a mechanical transmission system. When a train crosses, you will see that they leave a particular lever is pulled, and then the force gets transmitted from that station to a far away crossing point. But since it is a mechanical transmission system of the signal, it has invariably lot of losses. That is why many a times it is to be oiled, properly aligned, etcetera. But if the same signal, like what happens today, most of the cases it is completely automatized. So, it goes as an electric signal, not as a mechanical signal. So, that is the good part of an electric charge, that if the signal is produced in terms of electric charge, you can take it to a long distance to study what is happening to it. And suppose if it is not electric charge, it is magnetic flux, still we can use it, because we know the Lorentz law, we know, you know, how you can convert the magnetic flux in terms of electric current. So, you can still use this system. So, a smart sensor must be based on multifunctional material, which will enable it to sense both external and internal environment, and it basically produces a significant change in electric charge and magnetic flux. Now, what are these multifunctional materials? These are some of the very advanced engineering materials, like piezo ceramics, like electroactive polymers, magnetostrictive materials, and invariably in all these materials, it actually show coupled effects like producing electric charges or magnetic fields during mechanical deformation. Okay. So, those materials which show a very significant change in non-mechanical properties, mostly in terms of electric charges and magnetic fields, while subjected to mechanical deformation, are actually broadly classified as multifunctional materials. Okay. So, that is what is the smart materials consist of. Now, whenever I saw I show this slide, I invariably show a counter slide also, I have grouped all these possible smartnesses that is there in it in terms of output and input. So, if you look at it, that if I provide an input to the system, it could be in the form of applying a voltage like electric field or magnetic field or stress or heat or light. And in the output, we try to measure current or charge, magnetization, strain, temperature or light. Now, if you look at the diagonal terms, this is what a normal material, so called single functional materials, will show behaving along the diagonal track. For example, any normal mechanical material which is used for mechanical purposes, load carrying purposes, will actually undergo strain if it is subjected to stress, and elastic modulus governs the property, very straightforward. Any insulating material, if you apply electric field, it will develop charge, and it is the permittivity or the dielectric constant which takes care of it, very normal about it. Conductive materials, it is the conductivity that takes care of it. But if by applying electric field you can generate strain, then in addition to permittivity, this additional property makes it multifunctional. Similarly, in addition to stress creating deformation, suppose if the stress is creating something like current or charge, then this is a direct piezoelectric effect, and then it becomes immediately that group of materials become multifunctional material. So, that is why this table we have to keep in our mind. Interestingly, there are things like which are coming up very rapidly, not so far very popular, things like light. So, light changes phases of light is the refractive index, for example, but light creating strain, I am applying light and suppose this fellow starts to deform, that is what is called photostriction. That is something that happens in a biological system like the sunflowers and things like that, right? Photostriction or photonasty you will always find, but so far we do not have a commercially available material which actually shows this kind of actuation. But that is why all these interesting possibilities along the cross diagonals are there for us to explore in terms of new advanced multifunctional materials. What is the name of the chart? Tell me.
The name of this chart.
This is a chart that I have prepared. All the multifunctional materials together, I have classified them. So that we can see that in front of us, what are the various possibilities. Some of them we know it exists, some of them there is a question still, and that is what we can always look for. Some examples. Some examples, if we try to see, as very common example is a piezoelectric sensor. For example, this is a barium titanate, it is a piezo ceramic. And I will later on talk about this particular material, but just what is getting demonstrated here is that if you apply forces around externally, how does it sense that force? That means it gets partly strained whenever you hit it around, you may not be able to hear the sound, basically the fellow is hitting all around, and you see there is a voltage production that is happening. And whenever you will be getting closer to the system, there will be more dynamic loading, and you will see that the voltage will be increasing more and more as you will go closer and closer to the system. So, this is a typical of a piezo ceramic material, which is piezoelectric in nature, and there by applying the force, you are incorporating strains, and that is incorporating the voltage in the system. As a very typical example of such a system. And you see that if you do more heating, you can get an even higher voltage out of the system. So, that is how the whole system works. Similarly, you know, this kind of systems can not only be used in terms of a simple you know, material, but you can actually use a sensor and you can use it for pipe health monitoring. This is a robot that we have developed jointly with Professor Harutoshi Ogai. As you can see it here, that there is this, you know, I will just run it once more to explain the system to you. As you can see that there is this probe going on, you must have seen this robot in the other day, and there are these probes there. So, the robot as it is going on, this probe is hitting the, you know, obstructions, and as it is hitting, there is a voltage production that is happening in the system. In fact, towards the end of today's session, we will be able to see how to actually correctly model this kind of a situation. So, piezoelectric materials thus can be used as sensor, and this is just some example of it. Okay. Now, these are the broad group of smart sensors. Okay. Piezoelectric group, which creates an output in terms of electric charge; magnetostrictive group, which creates an output in terms of magnetic flux; electroactives in terms of again electric charge; optical fiber in terms of change in intensity or phase change of light; and shape memory alloy, which shows a phase change. This is a material related phase change that happens to the system. So, these are more or less, you know, 5 major groups of material which can be used as smart sensors. Now, what is the good part of this sensor? Of course, I told you that, you know, they have this both internal and external environment sensing capability. In addition to that, if you look at it, that their accuracy is quite remarkable. It is like, you know, sub micron level, 0.01 micrometer. Okay. So, that is one very good thing of it, that their accuracy is very, very high. And secondly, if you look at their response time, that is also very, very fast. Piezoelectrics, in fact, generally is considered to be the fastest, then the magnetostrictive and other materials. So, they have a fast response time and their accuracy is very, very high. These are the 2 very important things that you will need in any sensor development, because you want the sensor to react very fast, so that there is minimum amount of delay in the system and you can take all corrective actions. Okay. And the accuracy is of course important, because then you will be able to determine if there is a very small crack also in a pipe, for example, you will be able to determine. Hence, both of these are of immense value to us. Now, why piezoelectric materials, okay, can be used as a smart sensor? A little bit of, we have to know what is there in that material property that makes it, you know, so interesting as a smart material. So, here is an example of a very common piezoelectric material, barium titanate. Okay. If you look at the structure of it, it is something like, in a formula you can say it is ABO3. This ABO3 is nothing but a perovskite structure. Okay. And this perovskite structure generally creates a tetragonal symmetry in the system. However, in any crystal, we generally consider that the crystal is in mechanical equilibrium as well as in electrical equilibrium, meaning thereby that there should not be any charge, residual charge in a crystal, neither there should be a residual stress in a crystal, in an ideal crystal. But this ideal crystal definition never happens in this ABO3 structure. Why it does not happen is because if it wants to be in mechanical equilibrium, then it should be that this titanium should take exactly this central location, and then all the force equilibrium etcetera would occur to the system. However, what happens to the system, also please keep in mind that at this particular level, okay, the equilibrium of the forces is mostly based on electrostatic forces. Okay. The gravitational force do not play any role at that particular scale, right. So, electrostatically each one of them, the force that it is coming from the positive and the negatives like the oxygen, okay. So, they are, these forces should make it in a, should ideally speaking keep it at a perfectly balanced location. But this hardly happens, mostly because of the reason that this titanium, with a little bit of excitation, it is in a metastable condition, it shifts its location. And the moment it shifts its location, then what will happen is that there will be an overall charge in the system, and we call it spontaneous polarization. So, this kind of, you know, ABO3 structures always show a spontaneous polarization, which means a little bit of mechanical forces from outside will create enough disturbance such that this one shifts its location and a charge will get generated in it. However, not, you know, even if we know this piezoelectric property, it took a very, very long time for us to actually make a smart sensor which can show this change significantly. That significant change is very, very important. How long it take? It took nearly 100 years for us to come up with a solution where this thing can happen in a very significant manner. And one of the solution there, because there are many such, for example, PZT family today, lithium niobium family, lead niobium family, yttrium manganese family, and then this NH4 cadmium family. So, there are many such families which we now know today can actually show this behavior in a much more significant manner. And the significance came because of an artificial perovskite, because we were able to make an artificial perovskite. Okay. But this artificial perovskite, we really could not make it if we could not have discovered some pyrochloric materials in the nature beforehand. It is due to some discovery of rock samples which are pyrochloric in nature, and these are available mostly in places like Uganda and Brazil and places like that, where what you would find is that the ABO3 is just the fundamental one in the perovskite family. But if you have double ABO3s, that means A2B2O6, okay, or A3B3, okay, type, and then similarly A2B2O4, A3B3O6 or such higher orders, they become actually pyrochloric. Okay. Pyrochlorics are something which actually has different metastable phases inside the system. So, what it means is that it is not only a single source of titanium displacement in one crystal structure, and that too in a randomly polarized manner will give you a significant change. If you, for example, mix this one ABO3 with another ABO3, like where this titanium is partly substituted by zirconium at a ratio of 52 to 48, you will see the wonderful thing that would start to happen is that there will be local disorders that will be produced in the system, in which some will be titanium and some will be zirconium, and these local disorders that will create a very significant change in terms of the voltage generation of the system. So, that is how this lead zirconate titanate people made, and then they found getting inspired by this pyrochloric phase, that they are getting a good voltage output from the system when you are subjecting it to mechanical deformation. Of course, there are various ratios in which today it is obtained, in which you can mix it to get different types of properties. You have to keep in mind that in the earlier simple ABO3 system, I showed you that it is the tetrahedral form which actually generates these kind of piezoelectricity, but in this kind of mixing, depending on the temperature, you can get it in a rhombohedral form, cubic form or tetrahedral form, which means it can have multi phases, you know, or multiple crystal structures. Now, invariably there is a temperature beyond which the sensor would not work. Hence, whenever you will choose such material, it is always important to find out beyond which temperature the sensor would not work at all, and that temperature is the Curie temperature. So, what happens is that if you apply enough thermal energy to the system, then the crystals become very much, you know, they energized, and they would not behave in a piezoelectric manner. That means this polarization and the charge development would not happen in them anymore, and hence, you know, the piezoelectric property would be lost in such a system. So, this is the story of the perovskite materials. If you look at the polarization in this perovskite materials, you will see that the displacement of titanium can create the polarization in a positive or in a negative sense. Okay. In fact, you can artificially generate it with the application of external voltage itself. Okay. So, suppose I actually increase the external voltage to the system, that is the first line. What I will see is that more and more, you know, crystals are getting polarized. Okay. So, there are more dipole formations. Beyond a certain level, all the crystals will get polarized, and hence there will be a saturation in the system. Now, if I start to reduce the voltage, I will see that the polarization is coming down, but interestingly, even if we have a zero voltage, still there is some amount of spontaneous polarization in the system, and hence you will get a remnant polarization, okay, because there are already some of the crystals which get polarized on their own without any voltage support. So, that gives us the remnant polarization. Again, I reduce the voltage further and I get the shifting of the polarization from one direction to the other, because all the titanium will start to shift towards the other direction. Now, if I further change the voltage at 0 voltage, you will still, you know, at 0 polarization, you will still find that there is a voltage that will come in the system, okay, at the zero polarization itself, and that voltage is due to the coercive voltage in the system. So, this remnant polarization point here and the coercive voltage actually defines the more or less the spread of the hysteresis curve in the system. A sensor, please keep in mind, to be a good sensor must show as narrow hysteresis curve as possible. Okay. So, if it has too much of remnant polarization or too much of coercive voltage, then what will happen is that we will get all erroneous results around these points. Okay. We do not want it. So, we want it to be almost like a line, so that, you know, the voltage that it will generate will be exactly related to the strain that it will be subjected to. So, this is something that is why is of importance to us, to study what is the nature of the polarization in the system. Now, this is what, if you apply the voltage, so initially all the dipole moments in every crystal has a particular direction and they will be randomly polarized. Okay. So, that means the dipole directions are random in nature. The moment you apply a DC electric field, they will get, you know, into aligned themselves towards the direction of the voltage. And once you remove the voltage, this is the remnant polarization, as you can see that what should have had happened, once I remove the voltage, it should have gone back to the random stage, but it would not happen. There will be some which will remain still aligned towards the direction of the voltage. This is good for actuation, but this is not good for sensing purpose. Okay. So, that is why for sensor, we should look for very small remnant polarization in the system. Now, having said the material properties, we have to understand this constitutive equation of the system. So, there are a pair of constitutive equation, because it is multifunctional material, right. So, we always expect that there is a coupled phenomena that is happening in the system. Now, this is the simplest form of the coupled phenomena, okay, because there are actually many more terms that should go along with this, but this is the simplest form. In its simplest form, what it shows is that the electric field displacement, which is equivalent to charge actually, equals to some electromechanical coupling coefficient multiplied by stress. T here is the stress, okay, plus you have the permittivity multiplied by the electric field intensity. Okay. That is the first equation. The first equation is also known as a direct effect equation. So, what it says is that suppose I do not apply any electric field from outside, that means suppose I keep this E to be 0, then if I apply stress, I am getting electric field displacement, or in other words charge. So, stress generating electric potential or charge is the direct effect. Okay. So, that means this is the one which I can use for sensor development. If you look at the second one S is for strain, okay, and that can be created by stress for any normal material, but the multifunctionality comes into picture in the second term, where the electric field intensity can create strain. Okay. So, by applying the electric field as an input, I am getting strain, that is what is known as the converse effect. And this converse effect naturally is needed when I want to actually generate forces through this smart material, that means for actuator development. So, for sensor development, we will keep focusing on the direct effect, okay, whereas for the actuator development, we will go for the converse effect. As I told you that this whole system is far from only dependent on three parameters. In fact, the whole system depends on so many parameters, in which electric field is in one of the vertices, stress is in one, temperature is in another, and entropy, dielectric displacement and strains are the other three. So, total six parameters are actually continuously getting affected by each other in a realistic piezoelectric system, in which we have only seen the stress to electric field change and stress to strain change, or the other way round, right. These are the things that we have, this part of the triangle we have explored. We have not checked that what happens with respect to temperature to electricity, that is electrothermal effect, or temperature to stress, that is the thermoelastic effect. All these things can be actually used very much the same way we are using the piezoelectric effect. Okay. So, in fact, that is what is making us more and more complicated smart materials, where this multifunctionality increases its dimension. Is it that it is only the ABO3s which shows the piezoelectric property? No. There is these polymers also, which can show this piezoelectric property. Now, to do that, the polymers should be of a particular type. The polymer, first of all, should be of straight chains. As you can see, this is like, if this F you replace by H, what you get is a polyethylene. That means a straight chain polymer, okay, a linear polymer. However, from the linear polymer, instead of hanging hydrogen, if you can hang fluorine, okay, which has a much higher polarity, okay, which is much stronger in terms of electronegativity, then what will happen is that this is like, you know, all trans series of PVDF, it calls as a form 1 PVDF, then these chains, if I actually, you know, stress this chain mechanically, since this fluorine atoms also get shifted its location, and if it is the moment it gets shifted its location, it is very similar to what was happening due to the shifting of titanium. Right, the shifting of fluorine creates a charge in the system. Okay. So, that is what is so important in a PVDF material, that you must have straight chains with heavy pendants, heavy not in the sense of a mechanically heavy one, but in the sense of a polarity, that you must have a, you know, a much stronger you know, electronegative you know, atoms, so that you can get a higher piezoelectricity in the system. This is in fact was discovered by the Japanese people, and you know, it became very widely used in Japan. Now, the D3-1 of a, that means the electromechanical coupling coefficient of a piezoceramic versus a piezoelectric material, if you compare For piezoelectric it is 234, but here it is only between 4 to 19 picocoulomb for every newton of force. So, that means it is significantly less in comparison to PZT, but even if this is the case, the good part is that the modulus of elasticity is quite low for PVDM. The way it helps is that you can actually have then a piezoelectric material which you can spread over all uneven surfaces. Okay. So, this you know, this kind of flexibility that you get as it is a polymer, you do not get it in ceramics. So, the ceramics break very easily. Okay. However, these systems work in a much better manner for all those type of applications that we look for. That is why PVDF is not used as an actuator, but it is used more as a sensor. Okay. So, that is what is the good part of piezoelectric material. There is something here as the coupling factor K31, I will come to that, you know, when I will be discussing in one of the lectures, I will discuss about these coupling factors. Okay. This is nothing but the ratio of mechanical energy to electrical energy. In other words, the more mechanical energy can be transferred to electrical energy, you get higher signal from the system. That is what this fellow denotes. Okay. So, summarize that we are talking about direct effect, where stress is generating electric potential, and in the reverse effect, you know, the electric field generates the strain, which is used mostly in the actuator development. Okay. And that is what is generally, you know, the categorization of the smart material for sensing and actuation. Now, okay, this I have already discussed, so let us just go to the next point, that we have talked about the direct effect. The reverse effect then is used for actuation purpose. Okay. So, just this little video will show you that how one can use it as an actuation purpose. We use printers every day, right, without realizing that a printer has a very important piezoelectric element in it. So, if you look at it, this I have taken from the Epson site, Epson printer. Okay. And if you look at the video, you will see that how the reverse effect can be used as an actuator development. Okay. In fact, it is not only Epson, but all other printers today, HP printers, they all use the same technology. There is a piezo element there. If you open it up, if you ever get a bat printer, open it up, you will get the piezo element there, which can be in the bending form, which is called a bimorph form. And then this bimorph is sitting here. You apply a change of voltage, this works like a, you know, pumping machine, right, creating positive displacement, and that creates this flow of the fluid. Okay. So, as soon as you have a color command, you actually start to throw each one of these colors. Okay. And these colors are getting mixed one by one by one, and then further mixing, and what you get is a beautiful color printout of anything that you wish to do. Okay. So, the secret of today's color printing is actually with the piezoelectric material itself. Okay. So, you should try to catch hold of a, you know, printer which has gone wrong, and try to explore the piezoelectric material which is there in it. So, that is about the piezoelectric material, which is one of the so called good fellow, which shows both, you know, effect application as sensor as well as an actuator. Okay. Now, let us go to the other materials also. Another group of smart sensors are generally based on magnetostriction. So, magnetostriction is somewhat similar to the, you know, in terms of the constitutive equation, but the thing is that it is a little bit easier to handle in terms of the mechanical mathematical model of the system, so to say, than the piezoelectric material. Of course, it has nonlinearities. As long as you do not take into account the nonlinearity, it is easier to handle. The reason being that it is mostly unidirectional in nature. What I have not shown you so far, that piezoelectric material has actually a full fledged stress and a strain tensor. So, meaning thereby that you will you know, the same voltage will be or can be produced not only by axial stress, but also by shear stress, for example, okay, or axial stress from another direction. All these things are possible, but for magnetostrictive material this is unidirectional in nature, and the Joule effect actually tells us that, you know, if you apply the magnetic field, what is the strain that you are going to generate in the system. In other words, that is the converse effect for actuator development, and the Villari effect, which is used for sensor. So, that is the other type of smart sensor, where the stress will change the magnetic flux, you know, displacement or magnetic flux density. Okay. So, stress affecting the magnetic flux density, which can be picked up by a coil and can be shown in terms of a voltage generation, is what, you know, is used in terms of developing the magnetostrictive sensors. Okay. So, that is the second group of the smart material. Now, there are not only these direct Villari effect, where the applied stress creates a change in magnetization that is used, but also there are this Mathewsy effect, where the torque actually creates a helical anisotropy in terms of magnetic flux distribution, and the Nagoka-Honda effect, where there is a change in magnetic state due to change in the volume. Each one of them are also used in terms of sensor development. See, in the Villari effect, what happens? You can consider as if you have a rod, and then if there is a change in length of the rod, then there is a change of magnetization, which can be sensed as a pickup voltage. But in this case, it is like a block, and if this block is squeezed or the block is expanded, you get a change in magnetic state. So, that is different than the Villari effect, and in the second case, it is the torsion. So, you are twisting the material through which you are creating a helical anisotropy. Thus, each one of them has its own field of application. Okay. So, they are not exactly the same effect, even though the origin is because of the same material property of the system. Again, this can be used in pipeline application. I am not sure whether this will be able to run. We can make it a try. See that you can use it actually for two purposes, for developing a guided wave, that means as actuator, as well as for sensor. So, you first see this whole thing, then I will explain it to you. See, this is the gas pipeline, okay, and you are actually generating wave here, and to some distance you are actually generating a sensed signal. Okay. So, what you would do is that, suppose I send a wave from here, then this wave goes through the pipe surface itself, and you also you know, send the same wave as a electric field directly. So, there is a phase difference between the wave passing through the pipe and the wave which you are directly taking to the output side. That phase difference actually changes if there is a crack in the system. So, here it is showing that, you know, how you actually clean the surface, you cut this particular strip. Actually, it is something like your, you know, old day video strip. You can use that, in fact, to generate both guided wave as well as to sense it after a certain distance. And the cracks are all function of the delay in the system. So, now they are positioning the strip. You need to have a pickup coil. We generally, as you can see, that the monitoring sensor is having an integrated pickup coil in it, because the change of magnetic flux is to be sensed, right. So, that is what it is done, and you see this is the current source. Okay. So, you apply current, it will create a torsional wave, which will go through this particular pipe. Okay. And also, at a distance, you sense that current which is coming through the pipe, because that is creating a change of stress, since there is a change of magnetic flux. So, this pair of things you have to have, and through which you can continuously monitor what is happening between the two sensors. So, you see, you have to hold it in position very securely, and now the whole system is ready for the guided wave, you know, testing. And you can acquire the data. So, that is a typical use of such magnetostrictive material. Now, I will come to the third material. Okay. So, I have talked about piezoelectric material, which can be used for smart sensing, magnetostrictive material, which can be used for sensing cracks in a pipe, and then the third material, which group of materials which is based on shape memory. Okay. This is something which not many people have used as sensor, but in our group we have used it as sensor. Okay. So, hence it is something that has a merit of discussion, because it is mostly generated in IIT Kanpur. So, there are two common shape memory effects. Before we start to talk about it, I should explain what is this shape memory effect. Now, there are two common shape memory effects. One is called a one way and another is called a two way shape memory effect. Now, in the case of one way effect, the material actually has a memory only in one phase, that is the parent phase or the austenite phase. On the other hand, in the case of two way, it is trained in such a way that it has memory both in the austenite as well as in the martensite phase. So, there are these one way and two way shape memory effects. So, usually you will see that any shape memory material like nickel titanium alloy combination will have three very common states: austenite, twined martensite and detwined martensite. Austenite is the high temperature phase, as you can see it is beyond a particular temperature AF, and if you start to cool, stress is not coming into picture, assuming that, because there is always a third axis. I will come to that third axis soon, but if there is no change of stress, austenite will create a twined martensite phase. Then in the twined martensite phase, if you start to deform it, you get a detwined martensite phase. By this time you have done, you know, enough deformation to the material, so that, you know, it is not actually having the same shape as it has at the austenite state. But the moment you heat it, it is in a one way shape memory effect, it will exactly go to the same austenite phase shape, thereby giving it a memory effect. Okay. So, naturally the most abundant use of this kind of things are in terms of whenever you try to gain a shape. Okay. And in fact, that is basically similar to actuator applications where we try to gain a shape. Now, this is the entire effect in terms of, if you consider the stress also as a part of it, not just temperature and the strain. So, for example, here you are at a condition where the temperature is very, very small. Okay. So, you are already at the, you know, detwined martensite, twined martensite phase. Now, you are applying suppose stress to it. So, it gets detwined, I told you, it gets deformed heavily. Okay. So, you are at stress position 2. You withdraw the load, there will be some plastic deformation in the system. Okay. Now, you apply the temperature, you will see that it will come back to the same you know, state in terms of the strain. All the strain will vanish, it will come back to the same. And now, you cool it, you can go back to the same twined state from which you have started your journey. So, thus you can actually, you know, run this over and over in a cycle. So, that is what is the one way shape memory effect. I will not go into the two way, because for our work as sensor, this itself would suffice us. Now, how can you use SMA as sensor? Okay. The challenge came because we are working on a General Motors project, where they said that you will not be able to use any conventional electrical sensing technique. Okay. And this is, you have to develop an automobile turn indicator application. So, many of you have driven automobile, right. So, what we do even today in most of the cars, it's mechanically driven. So you put a left or a right indicator, then it starts to blink, okay, and then once you rotate the steering wheel to take the turn, and it will continue to blink. Once you reverse your turning, it will get automatically shut off, and that particular lever will come back to the neutral position. Okay. Now, our challenge was, we have to do the entire thing using shape memory alloy. That means this turning, has to be done automatically by the SMA actuator. Not only that, in addition, we have to sense this change of direction of rotation by using shape memory alloy itself. That was the challenge that we had. So, only SMA can be used for the whole purpose. It is a brilliant idea by some of the students. One is Om Prakash, he is now having his own company, and then there is another student who is in Korea right now. So, both of them worked very hard day and night to make it possible. This is a demonstration of auto cancellation feature in automobile turn indicator system using SMA. Okay. They have a voice over, but it will not be able to hear. So, let me tell about. So, this is the turn indicator, this is the steering wheel. Okay. You can assume this, and this is the turn indicator lever. Okay. We have basically taken it from a Maruti car, okay. And you have this SMA based micro switches. I will come to it in a minute. First you see how this whole thing is working, okay. And this is the power unit, so you can put this whole thing into power, okay. There is the battery part in it. Okay. So, what they are going to do, the moment they will put the power on, and then they can indicate that which way they are planning to do this. So, accordingly the indicator will be showing. So, they have kept the power on, and they have given a direction of rotation. See, accordingly the blinking has started now. Okay. So, you see it is rotating. Okay. As long as it is rotating, it is showing the blinking here. Now, you will see that as it will be, and this it will be sensing the SMA sensor that it is now turning back again. Okay. And you will see this will immediately come back to the position when that turning is reversed. You will see all of a sudden that this will come back. You see, it has come back to the location. So, this is for left side, and similarly you can see it once more if you try to go the other way round, that is in the other side. Okay. So, for that now he is going to give the indication. Now, here it is going to blink, that means you are taking a turn in this direction, and once again the moment you will return, okay, the SMA sensors are going to sense and it will send it back to the initial location. So, that is what you will see is going to happen to this system. Yeah, see, it has returned back. Now, this whole thing happens in this system with the use of only SMA sensor and SMA actuator. Okay. Why not? Definitely, but the challenge was to do it using SMA. Why it was like this? Because this is for a very special group of automobile which is known as Liberty. That has not been marketed yet. That is the state of the art GM car. GM has kept it somewhere. It is the one which has a flat chassis. That means it does not have any internal combustion engine, only fuel cell. Okay. So, it has a flat chassis, and these the turn indication actually takes lot of space. So, they wanted to get away with the mechanical system along with electrical turn indication sensing. They wanted to totally get away with it to make a very small compact system. That is why SMA came into the picture. Okay. So, whatever SMA is doing, any traditional sensor can also do it today, but SMA can do it in a much much better manner in a much less space. Okay. That is the advantage of shape memory alloy wire based system. Now, I have not still explained to you that what is the sensing in it, because actuation, many of you know that in fact, in my lab also many of you have used SMA as actuator, right. You have not used SMA as sensor. Okay. How many of you know about the existence of this work? You have seen this SMAS sensor? No, it is not that one. That also I will come. I will discuss that also, the resistance changing one. But this is not based on resistance. This is based on something else. So let us try to see it. Rohit might have seen it. Huh? Rohit? No, it is not the ISRO one then. It is a general motors. That is why I was thinking that how many people had seen it, because it happened long before. Okay? So let us see how this sensing is done. It is very, very simple. Actually, you know, Himanshu should try to follow it. Okay? So, you see it here that the way these, you know, it is done is actually copying, okay, in trees copying is a way of doing, right? Copying the optical encoder system. So, what we have done is that we have developed a disk in which there are conductive strips at angles which we have previously defined ourselves. Okay? So, these angles are fixed. Now, you have a record player kind of a system here, right? So, whenever this record player, it has two pins instead of single pin, whenever it touches these two, then there is a current flow. If it does not, so in order to have a conductive path, you must have. So, the other parts are all non-conductive, so current cannot flow. The moment you are into these two or these two, the current will flow. And the moment the current will flow, what is going to happen? You have two micro switches here, micro switch A and micro switch B. Okay? So, the moment current passes through each one of them, the micro switch is getting pressed. Okay? So, this micro switch A and micro getting pressed sequentially. Now, the difference between the two always tells you that how much you have advanced. And you see, you can only measure by whatever is the maximum, you know, number of this kind of strips that you can develop here. That is the limitation of encoder also. But in today's system, we have also thought of a three-dimensional way of doing the whole thing, so that you can increase the accuracy even beyond. Okay? So, essentially you are using SMA as actuator only, but you are using that by actually pressing some of the micro switches. Once again, we have opened up one of the printers and we have taken micro switches from there. But in a printer, the micro switches are operated by a mechanical system, in fact. But in this case, we are operating it using SMA wires. That is the difference. Okay?
SMA is used as an actuator here. No?
Yes. But what it is doing a sensing. That is why I am telling you. See the human mind, you know, how nice here. A small amount of current will press this micro switch. So, you are not heating too much. So, at the micro switch gets depressed and then once again it is rotating, no, fast rotating, the current will get detached and then it is off. So, it is like a pulse, you know, they call it, what is it called, pulse width modulation. It is in a PWM mode. So, that heating would not create any problem in such case, because it is for a very, very small time when for which you are doing it. I will just explain it to you in the next slide. So, that is your, you know, micro switch tip. This is the SMA wire, and actually we kept 3 SMAs in order to even create a wire bank, so that even if one gets heated, the other would do the job. That was the kind of the reason. And then, so this is the force that is happening to the system. That is the tensile force that we will need in the system. And the voltage, here you are applying only 1 volt. 260 milliampere of current. Okay. Diameter is 0.003 inch. In fact, this is what this team has so beautifully done. I request all of you who are developing your own sensors and actuators, please develop this kind of a table. Okay. Because many of you are doing, but where is the specification of the table? This is very, very important. Okay. The active length was 30 millimeter. They estimated the force, which is about 50 gram force. Operating frequency is 6 hertz, and SMA wire transformation was 80 degree transformation wire they had used. Modulus of elasticity shifting between 35 to 80 GPa. Okay? So, that is what is that whole system that has been used for the sensing of the angle. Okay, SMA as a sensor. Yeah, Arvind, we will start from your question.
I mean, for sensing, then I would ask for the hysteresis and then see like how far the upper thing is close to the center line and then by strength.
If you have to develop your own sensor, that means if you are not buying off the shelf sensor, only the smart material, then you have to ask for these properties, but many a times they will not give it. So, we actually characterize our own sensor, and that is very much possible, because we have voltage application facility, we have the sensing facility. So, we can actually sense how much of deformation we are getting as a positive and negative voltage. Okay. But that is the challenge. So, in this case, you are starting the system, get the pulse input from SMA based angle sensor, okay. And then there are three parts of the work. The first part is related to the rotation direction. So, you determine the phase difference between pulse 1 and pulse 2. If it is positive clockwise, if it is anticlockwise rotation, because you have two of them. Okay. So, it is sequentially the switch is, you know, AB type, right. So, if you see that this sequence is giving a positive phase, means it is clockwise. If it is negative phase, it is anticlockwise. So, thus you first sense that whether you are turning or you are turning back, because accordingly you have to, you know, use the other SMA actuator, which brings the you know, the lever back into the normal position. The second one is in terms of the angular value itself. Count the occurrence of pulse from SMA angle sensor. If direction is clockwise, increase every time the pulse is there angle by 10 degree. That is the minimum that we could have done in that system. It was a demonstration model. Or if the other direction, decrease the angle by 10 degree. So, thus you know what is the angle you have reached. For the third one, the, you know, that is where again two are needed, because you have to capture the velocity. So, what you do is that calculate the average time period, and then you know what is the distance, you know the arc length. Okay. So, you know the length between the two conductive strips. So, that length divided by the time is going to give you the angular velocity. So, thus from that same setup, you know what is your direction, you know what is your angle, and if you wish, you can also get the shaft rotational velocity. Of course, in that case it does not matter that what is the velocity, but there are other applications where you can use it. For example, for odometer application, you can actually use it. You know what was the good part of it, which we have not earlier understood. When we worked on the system, we found it is an excellent robust sensor, because in an automobile there will be always noises. Okay. Now, these noises, any electronic sensor will get very easily affected by the noises. But in this case, it will, because the SMA wires are there, they actually absorb, because SMA wires are to some extent, they are, you know, like passive damper. So, they absorb the noises. So, it becomes a much better system in comparison to the other you know, sensors. Okay. Another SMA based sensor that we have developed, which is exactly what Sahil is talking about, that is based on the resistance change. Okay.
So, there, if there is change in temperature, the environmental temperature there, so the sensor will produce some values for that. So, what are the techniques for temperature compensation for these sensors?
In this case, it is, and this actuation is for very small duration, hence it would not create a problem. In another case, it will, and you just look into this one. Okay. In this case, you have to actually calibrate it against this. So, look at this other SMA based sensor. This was done by another student. He was a MS student. The other two were in the project. This is Ajay Kumar Jain, and I have jointly guided him with Samir Khandekar, and most of the work was done in Samir's lab, but you might not have seen it, that here shape memory alloy based sensor is used for sensing two phase flow characteristics. So, what is a two phase flow? Just a bit of, you know, those who are not initiated to it, that, you know, you can actually generate in any flow, you know, you can artificially mix air, or there are possibilities of gases getting mixed in a flow, so that it does not remain only in one phase, in a liquid phase, but there is a liquid phase and a gaseous phase, both of them present in a system. Now, such a system is very widely used today for pulsating heat pipes. These are no normal heat pipes, which generally radiates heat using only the fluid, but heat pipes which has actually this kind of second phase, the gaseous phase, or a bubble entrapped into the system. And the performance of this heat pipe depends a lot on the characterization of this bubble, which means the speed of the bubble, the length of the bubble, etcetera, etcetera. So, that is what we wanted to do using this shape memory alloy wear based system. So, our objective was to characterize a two phase flow in different flow regimes. So, for example, there is this air bubble, this, and there is the liquid slug. So, we have to characterize what is the shape, size, spacing, etcetera, of this air bubbles. That was the challenge. It has applications in gas turbine based power plant, cooling circuit in nuclear reactors. In many cases, it has immense application if you can characterize it. What we have done here is that SMA wear is known to change its resistance with respect to the phase change. So, for example, at a low temperature level, you will see a low resistance in the system. As you increase the temperature, you will see the resistance is increasing. Then, when the phase change is happening, there is a sudden fall in the resistance, and once again the resistance starts to increase. Now, please keep in mind that with respect to temperature, resistance increasing is generally very normal in any other wear also. What makes SMA so special is not this increasing or this increasing trend, but this sudden drop actually. Basically, this is the time when the temperature actually goes for the phase transition of the system. That is why there is a sudden drop in the resistance of the system. So, there is a linear rise till the transition temperature austenite start, considerable decrease in resistance between AS to AF, and linear rise post austenite again. That is the general nature. And another important thing is that this nature also is sensitive to the stress. This is something that we have not so far developed any sensor. You can actually develop a stress sensor also out of it, because as you can see, at a low stress level, there is a lower change, and this is the pattern. At slightly higher stress level, this change increases even beyond, and at 266 megapascal, you get the highest change in the system. It goes to a much higher distance and then fall down. So, the pattern changes with respect to the stress. So, we have the input as the current, and we have the output in terms of the resistance. Now, people have earlier used wear mesh sensors, which simply measures the electrical conductivity. As you know, that if there is a flow and if there is a wear mesh sensor, what will happen? The liquid slug has a particular temperature. So, at the there is one conductivity and an output. At the moment you have a bubble here, then this conductivity would change. So, that is what people have earlier done. The difference in the electrical conductivity, and it detects local instantaneous cross sectional distribution of the phases, like the presence of the local bubbles. So, this is the thing in terms of change in conductivity. Similarly, it is done for capacitance change also. That means, where the permittivity is going to get changed, because you know that air or a bubble will have a different dielectric constant. So, you can either sense it, that is the conventional way, either sense it in terms of change in conductivity, or you can sense it in terms of change in capacitance. Now, what this fellow has thought of, that no, he will not use either of them, but he will use actually SMA wear. So, this is what is his plan of action. Place SMA wear across a cross section in the martensite phase, connect it with constant voltage source, and there is a two phase flow, medium 1 is oil, medium 2 is air. So, if it is in the oil phase, then there is more heat dissipation that will decrease the SMA temperature, it will remain in the martensite phase, there will be no change in resistance. If it is in the air, less heat dissipation will happen, which means there will be increase of SMA temperature, which means that it will go to austenite phase, which means there will be a significant decrease in resistance, and then you know you will be able to know that two phase flow is happening or not. That is the idea of this particular work.
Is it always straight between 0 to 100? I am not sure it is straight.
0 to 100?
0 to
100. I mean, that was what experimentally he has seen, but maybe he has joined it with lines. It may not be very straight, but he has actually, you know, considered a line joining the whole thing, basically. He has measured it at different temperature values. This much is sure, that this is experimentally obtained by him. Whether it is, it remains a perfect straight line or becomes zigzag, that is possible. Okay. So you see here that this is the SMA wire, okay, and what he is doing is that he is bringing it in touch with liquid of a temperature, and again in terms of you know, that's the first set of experiment, and again in touch of air. Okay. So this is a thermal bath cover in which he has given this, and he can actually visualize also the whole thing. So this is to capture the resistance temperature characteristics of the SMA wire. Okay. So constantly he is changing the temperature by using the, by changing the thermal bath temperature, and he is measuring the resistance across it. Okay. So he is using Teflon slab here and the thermal bath and data acquisition unit, etcetera, he has done. And he gets it in this manner. Now, this is very interesting. You have seen that earlier it starts from this point, no, and then it goes up. But when he was doing, he was not getting it from a very low value, he was getting it somewhere like 150 ohm per meter, then it goes to the top and then it shows the fall. And that was for a 100 micrometer SMA wire. Okay. So, he has done it for two things. Okay, for actually 5 different wires. One is 100 micrometer SMA, one is a silver coated simple conductive wire, another is a 375 micrometer SMA, a low transition temperature, and another is 375 high transition temperature, and another is copper wire. Okay. So, you see this is what he is getting. This is a silver coated wire continuously showing increase, as I told you, happens in most of the cases, and this is a copper wire which is also showing continuously showing the increase. But for 375 micrometer, you see the drop, and here also you see the drop. So, both the cases, as well as what I earlier shown you, the 100 micrometer, you see the drop. Okay. Only point is that the drop is not like first increasing and then dropping, but it is already to a high value and then dropping the whole thing. Okay. So, that is, and this answers your inquiry, right, that these are the points which are joined. Okay. So, it is not really very straight. So, once again, as you can see, now the temperature drop is very substantial for 375, this is 1.5 I think ohm per meter, 375 1.2 ohm per meter, high transition 1.2 ohm per meter, copper wire it is. So, you see it is an order of magnitude lower for copper wire or silver coated nano wires, etcetera. So, that means SMA is good actually, is much better than the other, you know, so called wire mesh system which is used. Okay. So, in this experiment he has taken this 25 degree cool to 0 degree and then back to 25 degree, then from 25 degree heat it to 130 degree and cool it to 25 degree. Okay. So, he has basically actually cooled it to 0 degree centigrade. The reason is that he wanted to get rid of that you know, small, that high value to begin with. Okay. So, and then what he is doing is that there is a SMA wire there, he also kept a standard resistor there, okay, and then he has measured the voltage drop. This is generally done in order to have a better sensitivity, because this is V measured over R standard. So, the smaller will be this value, then you will get a higher sensitivity into the system. So, This is the thing that he has followed, and as you can see that this is the set 1 cooling, and then you are set 1 heating, okay, and this is the set 2 heating and set 2 cooling. Okay. So, in one case you start from here, okay, so that is the cooling, and then that means, so this is the going back position and this is the heating position. Okay. So, in one case you actually follow this loop, and in another case you actually follow this loop. So, this also tells us another problem in the system, that it has quite a bit of hysteresis between heating and cooling. Okay. So, the resistance will fall down, but it is there is a bit of change between heating and the cooling part. So, that you have to actually do repeated experiments to train it, and then you should do it. Okay. In this case, for example, he kept the wire at 0 degree centigrade for 1 hour, resistance temperature behavior then matches during the cooling part. So, if you do this repeatedly, you will start to get this kind of a narrow hysteresis curve. Okay. Even though you start at a higher value, but you get a fall which is almost retraceable. For any sensor development, this retraceability or repeatability, that is what he has checked, that the repeatability is very, very important after single set, after 3 sets of experiments, etcetera. In the next experiment, what he has done is that he has found out what is this phase transformation time scale. Okay. That is very important, because the phase transformation happens at a particular speed. Now, if the air bubbles are at a much higher speed, then this phase transformation it will not be able to see. So, he has to find out what is the phase transformation time scale, how fast this resistance change, in other words, is occurring to the system. Okay. So, he has kept a different 6 sets, 0.23 second heating, 1.06 second in terms of cooling. Okay. Cooling, as you know always, that it is a little higher than the heating. Okay. But however, this gives you the time scale that we are talking about. So, if something is actually more than 2 seconds, in fact, the good part of is that for many conductivity or thermal related experiments, that temperature change is not that fast, that within within a second the temperature gets changed. No, it does not happen, it is slower than that. So, the moment he determined that this is what is my total temperature scale. So, if suppose any change that is happening due to the air bubble, which is something like in 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 100 seconds, definitely this fellow is going to see that phenomena, because all the changes happen in this fellow is within 1.5 seconds or so. That was the point of this particular experiment. He has done a very thorough experiment. Then in the third experiment, what he has done is that he has now used a solenoid valve and the air cylinder, and then he is injecting air, and through another control valve he is injecting the oil. Oil and air is getting mixed. There is a SMA wire which is watching this two phase flow. Okay, and the temperature of the SMA wire is controlled through thermal bath, and he is finding out the electrical output of the system. So, that is the whole system, as you can see here, that the thermal bath is controlling the SMA wire temperature, and he has the solenoid valves system for, so this is for the air cylinder part, and the solenoid valve for the liquid flow control. So, with this, what he has seen is that corresponding to various voltage categories, the input voltage is kept between 0.2 volt to 1.2, 1.3 to 1.8, 1.9 to 2.9. So, corresponding to various input voltage categories, when he is injecting these, what is the resistance change that is happening? In fact, what you can see is that in a lower voltage it is better, the higher voltage the temperature is more. As the temperature is more, the overall resistance comes down. So, it is lesser in this particular case. Okay. After that, he actually started a two phase flow and see that whether this fellow is able to see the two phase flow. The beauty is that it has not only seen the two phase flow, but also it has seen that inside the two phase flow itself, there is some variation that happens to the system. So you see here, this every change that is happening in these points corresponding to any voltage is actually the resistance drop that is happening to the system, and that is due to the phase change in the system. That means I told you that as the air bubble is coming, then you know it is retaining the heat, and as a result the resistance is dropping down, okay. And the air bubble is passing by, then what is happening is that it is gaining back the temperature because there is a liquid slug, okay. Interestingly, you will see that it is dropping down fine, but there is a little bit of overshoot that is happening every time, and that happens due to a secondary flow transition that happens into the system. So that is something that has not been seen earlier by wire mesh system, but the SMA has been able to very nicely depict this particular thing. So you see that detection of two phase flow, resistance drop behind air bubble, and just before air bubble what are the changes happening to the system, that also they are able to actually see in this particular case. That is the good part in this system. So that is what is shown for various voltages essentially, okay, the same phenomena. Okay, so I will just now try to, and what he has shown is that now not only if you can have one SMA wire, but if you have two SMA wires, then you can also actually find out the velocity in order to, because you know the known distance and you know this phase shift from one position, phase shift from another. So you know that what is the time that the bubble has taken to travel this distance. So that is how you know the experiment 4, he has actually found out the velocity of the system with respect to two SMA wires. So he has developed a MATLAB program. The first SMA wire air bubble start, second SMA wire air bubble start, you know the distance, you know the time difference, you can easily calculate the speed in the system. So I am just very quickly you know doing this whole thing just to show you that this has been done as a sensor. So I finally concluding thing is that SMA can be used for two phase flow detection, okay, because there is a resistance drop. Keep these points in your mind, whether you never know how the connectivity would come for pipe health monitoring, for characterization of the pipe flow characteristics itself, SMA can be used because there are many a times pollutants there in the pipe. Okay. So it can actually be used in terms of measurements of the presence of multiple phases. Different configurations of SMA wires can be used to determine additional parameters of two phase flows, like two of them parallelly can be used for speed measurements, etcetera. Input voltage is required, maximum frequency of the two phase flow depends on the fundamental characteristics of the SMA wires itself, depending on what transition temperature it is. Not only that, as I told you that this system, this whole system can be also used for stress measurement, because the resistance drop is also a function of stress. That is an important clue for us. For example, you know we will see in the next presentation that in the PVDF what happens is that whenever it actually goes through these you know cracks or things like that, there is a stress change in the system. So the stress change can be interpreted in terms of resistance change also. Okay. So that is what we will see in the next presentation. So this is what is the summary of the first part, that smart sensors are based on multifunctional materials. Most common group of smart materials are based on piezoelectricity. We have seen that you know how these materials can actually be used in terms of piezoelectric formation. Piezoelectric sensors can also be used as actuators. That is the good part of it. In fact, this is also known as self-sensing actuator. Okay. Yeah. Somewhat similar thing we had tried to do in SMA, but in a much more complicated manner. But piezoelectric material, it is very easy and straightforward. It is the sensor can also be used as actuator, and it is known as self-sensing actuators. Another common group I showed today is safe memory alloy, and there are at least two ways by which SMA can be used for sensing. The question is, can you think of similar innovative sensor development? Okay, if you can, then only the lecture will be successful, right, that to trigger some thought process in your mind. So this is where I want to put an end of the first talk, right. So, now we can have some questions if you wish.
Thermoelectric means for piezoelectric material? Thermoelectric in the sense the shape will be allowed?
No, sir, it's still
right. I showed you that the wire mesh sensors, right, they actually use that, that because of the temperature change, if you look at it, this is the thing, this or this one, right, the silver coated wire or the copper wire. There, if there is a change of temperature, the resistance is changing, resistance is increasing. My point is that this is only in the level of 0.08 ohm per meter or, you know, 0.1 ohm per meter, etcetera. But in SMA, it is at a much, much higher level. It is 10 times higher, at least. Yeah, it is more, much more, you know. I was thinking for a moment that maybe Seebeck effect or Peltier effect, but what she is telling is not only voltage generation, but also as temperature sensing itself.
Yeah,
say for example, thermocouples. Thermocouples essentially use the same principle, right? That you have a hot joint and a cold joint, and that creates an EMF generation. This is.
So the drawback of SMA wave sensor as a is that it, the temperature should be between 0 to 100.
No, the temperature should be between S and A.
Of course.
Otherwise, it will not be sensing. That's the drawback.
Right?
No, not AS and AF, but yes. You are showing it is linear, between 0 to 100. No. This happens if you look at it just
even before. In the first graph.
First graph, let us go.
Yes.
You see this. This is the region where the change is happening. This part of the change is not that significant, but this happens between austenite start and austenite finish, because there is a phase change in the system. So, somehow you have to have an idea that your system change is happening here, then it will be cool. Basically, in Ojai's work, he has only used this as a switch, on off switch, not more than that. He has not even taken point by point value that I am getting this much of resistance since this is my temperature. No, he has not even done that. What he has done is that he intelligently kept this thing happening whenever that air and this thing is. So that is where, so that means he has artificially increased, that's why he needs power. He has artificially increased the temperature of the SMA wire and kept it just at this level. So that whenever the, you know, air bubble is passing, this is dropping down, is happening to the system. Yeah.
Another question. You talk about Curie point. The point after which material loses.
Yes, for piezoelectric material.
But
yeah.
If I give it a temperature equal to Curie point and then remove the temperature, will it lose its behavior permanently?
Yes, it's true. It goes away permanently because you need to, basically it becomes randomly polarized after that. Once even if you come down, so you have to recharge the system.
Material structure itself you have
reported? No, only polarization will become random, so which means you have to once again repolarize the whole system by using again a DC voltage and repolarize, align all of them, and then you start to use it. It will not be a permanent damage, but at that stage you will not be able to use it unless you further process it.
So, material repolarization is possible in all piezoelectric SMA and other?
Yeah. That is possible. Yeah.
Is
Yeah, that is very, very important. In fact, that we have not discussed yet today. See, for health monitoring, there is one particular area which is called healing. In the healing, SMA can be used for enormous applications, like the SMA wear itself, if it gets heated, then it goes to austenite phase, which means it goes to a higher modulus, which means it stiffens the system. So that stiffening can be used in terms of crack arresting, okay, or crack deflection, it can be used. So that is definitely one area which is so far not explored, and we should work on that.
For sensing purposes.
Okay, for sensing purposes, phase change, see, yes, it can be used in this manner. Once you think of it, it is mostly the stress-induced change, stress-induced martensite transformation. For structural health monitoring, I am talking about. In this case, it is temperature sensing. But in structural health monitoring, what can happen is that if there is a change of stress because of the crack development, suppose, the stress may increase. If there is a stress concentration and SMA wear happens to be close to it, there is a change of stress. So the change of stress will have two effects on it. One is that if it is already in the austenite phase, then the damping will be more, because stress induced, if it is in the martensite phase, but if the transition temperature is low, then the damping will be more because of stress induced transformation. The other one that can happen is that is what I told you today, that you see this curve, that with respect to change of stress, the resistance change is different. So you can actually use it for resistance, for the stress sensing itself, because the resistance is continuously changing. See, the 266 MPa, okay, the same temperature level, suppose we are at this temperature level, 50 degree, okay. And with 89 MPa, your resistance is 5.4 ohm. And with 266 MPa, that means if the stress increases in the system, you are going to some 5.8 MPa or so, okay, 5.8 ohm per meter. So resistance is increasing in the system. So that way also one can use it as a stress sensor.
Also, that would be cyclic.
Yeah, that would be cyclic. You again reduce the stress level, again it will start to follow this. Of course, experiments have to be done on it.
One thing also, sir, that is about magnetostrictive materials.
Yeah.
So in all these sensors, like SMA wires, that are all single axis sensors. So in single direction or maybe single axis, we can sense whatever the deflection or changes in.
Not all of them, except piezoelectric. Piezoelectric, the triaxial accelerometers. Piezoelectric is direction.
So,
yeah.
So which maybe we can prefer as a sensor, if we need to measure all the three axis measurements, then we can use either piezoelectric or as well as magnetostrictive.
For magnetostrictive, then you need either a triaxial one, or you need this particular effect that I told you, that there is a Nagoka-Honda effect.
Yes. You so can volumetric use that. Changes.
Because that shows a volumetric change.
So that will give us all x, y, z components.
Correct.
So then it
accurate. Yes, that can be. But all these things have not been done. All these things are to be done. See, the fields are wide open actually.
Which is to be much more suitable and precise and low cost? Piezo or
There is one thing that I did not tell you, that magnetostrictive material has a much higher energy density than the piezoelectric material.
So much resolution.
Yeah, so you can get a very high sensitivity, something like, I can just show it to you. That will give you an idea of, it is like a small mini bomb actually. I'll just show you, yeah. Just bear with me for a minute. Yeah. No, this will not work today, right? Yeah, see this magnetostrictive material. Huge energy key sensor. It has a huge potential, but it is very difficult to analyze.
So, same case is possible in piezoelectric material.
Yeah, piezoelectric material every day you do it. The gas lighter that today you do is no longer a gas lighter. You actually use piezoelectric material, but the energy density is less. Okay, so I think let us stop here. Yeah, please.
Last slide, you showed that there is a decrease in resistance with increase in temperature.
Yeah.
This is somewhat short of negative resistance coefficient.
Correct.
So,
what is the definition of smart material that I will say? Multifunctional. Correct? So, this fellow not only responds to this chain, but also it can be used as a load bearing material. But not many semiconductive material can actually take mechanical loading. Otherwise, they can be definitely used. Semiconductive material are used already as sensor. All this optical fiber is of course a smart material, which has multifunctional. See, what I am telling is that a semiconductor material has only one functionality, right? And that is also true for a thermocouple or any other sensor. A single work, it works very well. But when you are thinking of doing one more additional work at least through the system, then you need to think of this kind of materials, because they can be used as actuator also.
But in the two phase that experiment you have shown,
it is only a sensor.
Only a sensor.
Yeah.
But you are not using you are using not only a.
You are not using as actuator. Yeah.
Yeah.
It is only a sensor.
Carbon nanotube for incarnation.
Can be used. Yes. Why not? Resistance happens in that also. Okay, so let's put a name here.